If there's one debate that seems to get different genetic genealogists riled up, it is about small segments and whether or not we should even be looking at them. So let me try to tackle a couple of issues with small segments today. Howdy, welcome to Family History Fanatics, where we love helping you climb your family tree and have fun along the way. Small segments happen in DNA, and if you go onto Facebook in any of the genetic genealogy groups, you're going to find debates that are going on between people about whether or not they should be looking at small segments and whether or not these small segments can actually be used for genetic genealogy. So let me start by going with a basic question. What is a small segment to begin with? How is it really defined? And with any new field, in a lot of cases, these things are somewhat fluid, and there may not be a exact definition. So I'm going to start with a definition of, hey, a small segment is less than about 7 centimorgans, which seems a little bit mealy-mouthed there, because I'm using less than and an about in the same sentence. Some people may say it's less than 10, some people may say it's less than 6, but somewhere around there, we all, I think, agree is where the small segments start. The exact point where they all start, we don't agree. But somewhere between this, 5 to 10, small segments start. So I'm just going to use less than about 7 centimorgans. The other thing about small segments is that this is where the probability of false match begins to be larger than the probability of a real match. Now, I'm not going to go into everything about a false match today. One thing to look at for a false match is if you have that match and neither one of your parents has that match, then it's a false match. And that usually happens in these really small centimorgans. With that definition, let's go and let's take a look at some data. Now, I went through and I found 4 data sets. Not all of them are, in fact, none of them, are using the same method to come up with their information. They have different algorithms to calculate this. Some of them are using different data sets in order to accomplish this, and some of them define things in a little bit different ways. What I've tried to do with this is I've tried to basically simplify it down into calling a false segment, and then using the information that they have to identify what they consider percentage-wise what a false segment is. So let me start with a table that you can actually find on the ISOG wiki. And this was from John Walden, some research that he did that was reported to Tim Jansen. So we'll just call this John Walden and Tim Jansen's data. What they found is that at around 13 centimorgans, there's really no false segments. But as you go progressively lower than that, false segments start to increase. At 10 centimorgans, it's only about 4%, which is still really low. But by the time you get to 7 centimorgans, it's almost a third, or really a third, of all of the segments are false segments. And it gets progressively worse as you go down from there, to the point where at 3 centimorgans, you're looking at 89% of those segments are false segments. So that's our first data set. Now, Family Tree DNA just recently came out with a white paper that explains some of their methodology, and they had a similar table with, would you guess, actually somewhat similar, although varied a bit, results. Again, at 13 centimorgans, they find about 1% are false segments, which is very comparable to what John Walden and Tim Jansen have found. And that goes up to about 2% at 10. At 7, it's only 10% as opposed to the 33%. But there you can see this trend is still, it gets progressively worse. In fact, their 4 centimorgans and 3 centimorgans show a lot more false segments than what John Walden and Tim Jansen found. In fact, at 3 centimorgans, 97%, I mean, that is almost all of the segments you're looking at are false. Only 1 out of 33 segments are going to be true segments. That's a lot of matches to go through to be able to find different things that are going to be helpful for you. Now, with Ancestry DNA, they didn't have a nice paper like Family Tree DNA or a nice table like John Walden and Tim Jansen did. So I had to extract some of this from some different graphs that they had with the explanations. So some of this may not be exactly the same as what we were looking at before, but I think it's close enough. And what I've found is that obviously the trend here is the same. 13 centimorgans, they're seeing about 3% false segments. Going down to 6 centimorgans, it's about 50% false segments. And then we have 23andMe. They also looked at this, again, in a different way, and I had to extract some of this data from just tables that they had. But starting at 6 centimorgans, they're finding about 15% false segments, all the way down to 3 centimorgans, where they're seeing as much as 70% false segments. It's a lot of data, and it's good to actually look at it all together. Now, there's obviously variability between each one of these groups because of how they looked at it, what algorithms they're using, what data they're using to be able to come up with this information. Overall, though, one of the things that we can see is that there is a definite trend once you hit 7 centimorgans that the amount of false segments goes up rapidly. Above 7 centimorgans, particularly above 10 centimorgans, there's very few false segments that anybody is finding. And so I think that we can agree from these four different data sets that as we go down in the size, we're going to see more and more false segments. And if you want to know why false segments might be bad, then you can watch a video that we have on this channel about false segments. Now, previously, I've covered about the extra effort then that having to sort through these false segments is to where your genealogy work, you're going to be running down a lot of rabbit holes. Now, Blaine Bettinger calls these false segments poison. I wouldn't go that far. I would call them a total waste of time because when you think of some of these at 3 centimorgans, where if 97% is the correct number, that means you're having to go and look through 33 of these false segments to find one true segment. If you just assume that you're spending an hour on each match, you spent 33 hours. Only one of those hours was actually fruitful. The other 32 hours were really totally wasted. So I don't want to go into that anymore here. But what I want to look at is something else statistically. So if we have this small segment, we'll just say at 7 centimorgans. So what can possibly happen with this small segment? Well, there's three things. One, this small segment cannot be passed on to the children. Two, this small segment could be passed on intact. And then three, this small segment could be passed on recombined. In other words, it becomes an even smaller segment. Instead of a 7 centimorgan, now it's maybe a 6 or a 5 or a 4 or a 3 centimorgan segment. Now looking at this, you see that there's three possibilities and you might be thinking, okay, well there's a 33% chance of any one of these happening. And you'd be wrong. It's not 33%. So let's look at this a different way. We have here, green represents that segment. So in this first block that you see, that totally green, that means the segment is passed on totally intact. The next block is white, that means the segment is not passed on at all. And then the other 12 are how that segment might be divided up if we're just going by centimorgan. So we could have the first little centimorgan of it and the rest not passed on, all the way up to all the first part not being passed on, but the last centimorgan of that being passed on. So here's all the possibilities of what could be passed on without dividing up centimorgans into half centimorgans or quarter centimorgans. And in this case, we end up with 14 possibilities. So remember, I said before there was three possibilities, but if we really expand these out, there's 14 possibilities. And simple statistics of saying, well, 14 possibilities divided by 100 would be 7% of any one of these happening. And that would be wrong as well. It's not that simple. So let's go back to what a centimorgan is. So a centimorgan, the definition of a centimorgan is a little confusing. And I haven't made a video about what a centimorgan is, but in essence, a centimorgan is 1% probability of a recombination happening. So another way of looking at that is a centimorgan is a 99% probability of no recombination happening. So in our hypothetical 7 centimorgan, what we have is we have a 99% times 99% times 99% times 99% 99 99 99 so 7 times 99% probability of no recombination happening. If we do the math here, what that means is there's really a 93% probability of no recombination happening. In other words, all of these recombined segments, these much smaller segments being passed on, there's only a 7% probability of any of those happening. So any of those, there's only a 7%, not 7% each, but 7% total for that entire group. So 12 of the 14 possibilities only have a 7% chance of happening, which leaves 93% between the other two. And this is where we can actually do some simple math and just divide by two. I've rounded up. So each one has a 42% probability of happening. There's a 42% probability of this 7 centimorgan segment being passed on intact. There's also a 42% probability of none of that segment being passed on. So interestingly enough, if we take a look at a great grandparent, they have a 42% probability of passing on this 7 centimorgan segment to a grandparent. And that grandparent also has a 42% probability of passing on that 7 centimorgan segment to the parent. And that parent has a 42% probability of passing on that 7 centimorgan segment to the child, to you, in essence. If we actually multiply all of those together, what we get is 7.4%. In other words, with a 7 centimorgan segment, it is more likely that you receive that exact segment intact for 3 generations. So it's the exact same 7 centimorgan segment that your great grandparent had. That is a higher likelihood of happening than you passing on a recombined version of that segment. In other words, a shortened version of that segment to your child. And this is one of the reasons why when we look at these small segments, we can actually see that they get passed down from generation to generation to generation. It's because at that point, once you're down to around 7 centimorgans, it's much more likely that it's either going to be passed on intact or it's not going to be passed on at all than it is that it's going to be divided up. So that's one of the things that can happen with these small segments is being divided up into an even smaller segment is very unlikely. And so starting roughly at about 7 centimorgans, you're going to have more of a chance of actually finding these passed down multiple generations intact than you are going to find that segment being divided up in succeeding generations. If you still have questions about DNA, then consider joining us for our live streams where we answer your DNA questions or become an FHF extra member where we have even more training and live streams to answer your questions. Now, if you'd like to learn how DNA is passed down through generations, this is actually an older video I made. You can watch this video up here. But if you want to learn something else about DNA, then why don't you watch this video down below? 7% is the correct, or sorry, is passed, or sorry. Okay, my nose is itching.